30 in the Church of Scotland Mission Station Hospital. Just if you can forgive my pronunciations, I'm not a Transkei, so I might have come up with some weird ways of saying things. In the district of Kumbu. And he grew up in the village of Libode, where his father was a trader in a trading store. And after attending school and matriculating from high school, from Umtata High School in 1947, he applied for a position in the civil service, as it was called those days. He was appointed as a clerk, and over the many years of his career, he worked his way up to becoming a magistrate. He served in 12 different magistratural districts, namely Umtata, Butterworth, Engcobo, Libode, Flagstaff, Lusikisiki, Matsati, and then back to Libode in 1969 as a senior magistrate. And then in 1974 he was promoted back to Engcobo as a principal magistrate. He then was transferred to Umtata as an acting chief magistrate in 1988. He retired on the 31st of March 1990 after 43 years of service under four governmental administrations, namely General Smuts's administration, the Nationalists, Matanzima after the Transkei independence was granted, and lastly the General Olamisa after a military coup in the Transkei. So he's had been in the wars. he purchased his retirement home in Bonza Bay and has continued to be involved with Vincent Methodist Church as a treasurer and also vice chairman of the Men's League. He was also head deacon at the Christian Center at one time. It gives me great pleasure to welcome Des, and I'm sure you're all enjoying your talk as well. Thank you.
And on this picture, I was a junior in 63. We were all sitting on the grass, the seniors above us and the big boys that were there. And right in the corner is Bob Hutchison. So I didn't know that his son was here. But he's got the same picture. He came to show it to me. I said, I've got it with me. I've got it in my hand here. So I thought it would be interesting, but you've seen it all. So, it's mine. Yours is nice and new. Mine is all dogged and you all know. But thank you for introducing me, and it's good to be here. I was actually hijacked by this lady sitting over here because I gave a talk to the ladies. First, gave a talk to our church. We have a similar thing there. We have a men's league. We meet first Tuesday. But we have a dinner. So the ladies at church only cook us dinner there. So we have dinner and then we talk, and the pastor gives a talk, and then we have speaker. And we ran out of speakers and they asked me to speak, so I spoke. And then the guy from Provis saw me, heard it, and he said, come to Provis. I went to Provis. And the ladies group said, please come first, while we do them. And then she's part of the ladies group. He said, oh, no, that's historical, you must come to the historical society. So now I'm finished talking now. I'm not talking about myself now, you know? I'm talking about something else. And so people asked me to come, so I said, okay. I said, but I'm not going out at night time. My kids don't want me to drive at night because I don't see the world and I'll get lost. And so she had to come and fetch me. So apologies for late. My taxi was a bit late. But anyway, thanks for introducing me. And my title is The Life and Times of a Transkeian Magistrate. You might ask me, why do I say Transkeian Magistrate? Because not just magistrate, because I was born in the Transkei, bred there, and my entire career was in the Transkei. Some guys were transferred out to other places, but I was stuck there. Quite a few were stuck there. I don't think Bob ever lived in Transkei either. My father, I don't know. But yeah, I don't think I said, well, you know, the nearest I can get is a ref, referee. Let's say a rugby referee. Because you've got to know the rules, you must be able to interpret them correctly and fairly and make decisions without fear, fear, and bias. That's what a ref's got to do. But what I'm talking about tonight, as you realize, it took place a long, long time ago, because I joined the service 70 years ago. And I retired 27 years ago. So, in the last 27 years, things have changed completely, as you well know. It's nothing like it anymore. I think if I went back to court, I wouldn't even know what to do there. But anyway, you've heard, I just want to share a couple of my highlights. First, what I saw on the other bank, on the gritty. But you know, when I left, I'd served for 2 years in my hometown, that's what I did. Where Bob Hutchison and I served together as clerks with some other guys, and then we both got transferred. When I left there, you know, the little towns of the Transkei, they give everybody a send-off. So I gave out a send-off there. And I think, you know, if you were buy a couple of castle lights, they still had a castle in those days. They weren't light, but they were castle strong. And I said to these guys, I said, I'm going to come back. I don't touch it anymore, thank goodness. But I said to these guys, I'm going to come back one day as your magistrate. And they laughed at me, you know, and there's a 19-year-old boy, and he's going to come back as the Mikey, as they call him. But you'll see there, 20 years later, I did come back as the magistrate. But while I was passing my law when I was 20, and I had been made a prosecutor in Ntata, interesting point in Ntata those days, it was the only place in the Transkei that had civil service prosecutors. In all other little dorps, the police sergeant had to be the prosecutor. He was the prosecutor. Because Ntata was the biggest court in the country in the Transkei, and they had many more magistrates. Some places only had two magistrates, some had three, some had four. Ntata had a couple of Desmond, but I don't know those days. But so I was saying, then I learned a lot there. But it was learning. Then of course I got my first promotion to the bench was in 1954. I was appointed assistant magistrate in Butterworth, and I tried my first case. Now, I don't know who's more scared, the bloke sitting there and me. You're scared, you're going to make a mess of it, and you want to make the right things, right decisions. But it turned out for the best, because this bloke, there's a nasty case of assault, and he hanged somebody on the head and landed him in hospital, and I gave him 6 months, no fine. And I said, yo. The people were so amazed. Apparently the bloke before me had been a bit lenient, you know. This new bikey comes along and he puts him straight in jail, no fine, you know. But it was a good start anyway. And what I found that was being a Transkei born and bred, I could speak the lingo. So I knew what was being said. Before it was even translated, because everything was had to be translated, because the legal system is in English, but you had everybody was personally speaking, you know, even the attorneys were African. But all in English, but I could speak it, so I knew exactly what is being said before it was translated. Which is a very good thing, because sometimes these interpreters were not up to scratch. Party education didn't produce very good interpreters, but that English wasn't very, very good. And I often had to say, look, here, man, hey, this guy said A, B, and C. Everybody said A, B, what about C? Oh, Libe, what? Yeah. So it is, I found that they have to speak the language. Benefit and advantage to me, because also in my other work, part of the bank on the bench, the magistrate in Transkei was, God knows, he ran the whole country, he just about did everything. And I go to a meeting and I knew what to conduct the meeting, interpret what they said, what I said, because I knew what they were saying to me. I said, no, keep on, I know what they're saying, you interpret what I speak, you know. So things went up much quicker that way, because things were speeded up. But of course, then in 1963 I got promoted to magistrate, and that was the big fish, because now I was number one. Now I was no longer number two or number three or something like that. Now I was given my own office, my own district, and I was a magistrate. And I was 33, and the people said, oh my God, you're too young to be a magistrate. I don't know, they're all in their 40s. I said, well, things have changed now, man. My colleagues, we're all youngsters now these days. Yes. But that was a big fish, because being put in charge of your own office. And the other, of course, the other big thing came was that, as you heard, in 1969, I was promoted to a senior magistrate, and I was sent back to my hometown. And I went back there, and there was some of the old folks who were still there. And I said, hey, you remember 20 years ago, I said I was coming back. I'm back. the appointment, of course, was well received by the people and the African people, and the paramount chief of the Pondos even came to welcome me as the son of the soil had returned, you know, this big thing. And you could speak to you part of the scene, and they knew my parents, and said, oh, you were good, you were doing this, and they know that. So, marvelous, anyway. But that was that. But a bit about the Transkei, for those who don't know, because I think a lot of guys here know Transkei, but it consists of 26 districts, stretching from the Kai River to the Natal border and from the Indian Ocean to the Darkness, which is about. That's just roughly the size of it. And after independence, they added on Lady Frey and Sterkspruit, I think just on the demand of Tanzimat. It was given back to him. And the East District was divided up into what they called administrative areas. They first called locations, but then they did away with the word location. They called them administrative areas, and they had headmen in charge of these. And then these areas were divided up into groups according to tribe under the chief, and they formed a tribal authority. But these tribal authorities were the nucleus of the future government, of the self-government and the independent government. That was that we were actually teaching them how to run a country, how to do things. And we built courthouses at the chief's place there. Courthouse with two offices, one for him and one for the secretary, and that's what there was the whole administration. So the whole administration revolved around and right on the cooperation of the chief and headman. They were out linked to the people. And another thing is, although part of the Cape Province, the Transkei was governed as far as the rural areas were concerned by a proclamation of the Governor General, who later became the state president. And the Transkei had many of its own laws, not applicable anywhere else. They had a criminal law code, Act Number 24 of 1886. I'll never forget, I knew that in my heart, because I don't know where it was passed, I presume in Cape Town or somewhere, but it was based on the criminal code of India. And it must be a colonial thing, I suppose, like it. But they had crimes like galloping a horse down the main street and things like that, you know. Every crime of Godworth was mentioned in there. They had a liquor proclamation only applicable to the Transkei. They had a proclamation there which banned Indians from living or even travelling through the Transkei. Indians wanted to go from Durban to Cape Town, had to go and apply for a permit to travel, and he had to head out of the Transkei before the sunset. He couldn't sleep the night over there. His car broke down, I don't know if he was in trouble, he had to report to the police. So there were special laws about carrying dangerous weapons, about witchcraft, which is very, very rife in the Transkei. You still hear about witchcraft even now when people are being slaughtered because they believe they're a witch. Mm-hmm. African people, my experience was they don't believe anybody dies naturally. If somebody dies, then somebody's killed him, you know? And really, it was mostly old women that were really blamed as being the witches and were murdered very cruelly. There was laws, of course, the laws governing the occupation of land also was part of the Transkei only. And another thing, of course, you know that Matanzima was hurt because he was a good guy. I mean, I liked him very much because he had got things done with all his faults. And the traders complained to us that they were being plagued by these young girls who were printing cosmetics and stuff like that. And the courts couldn't do a thing with them. So we couldn't, because you couldn't put them in jail. You couldn't give them cuts, because in those days you could give people cuts. We got cuts at school, and the Pekingese got cuts when they got convicted in court. We had a lot of theft, and they got six cuts with a light cane at the charge office, and dang, 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 off they go. That's the end of the story. So the traders went to my cousin and complained that these kids were pinching wholesale from them, and the courts couldn't do a thing with them. We had to give them a fine, because mom and dad had to pay for it. So I told them, okay, to us and said, why don't you give them cuts? I said, we're not allowed to, sir. He said, who said so? I said, it's in the law. Whose law? That's the way he spoke. He said, it's the law, they have criminal law. He said, well, I'm changing that. He said, I'm changing that. He said, because our custom is that girls get a hard exam as well as the boys. There's no such thing as boys can't even be. And he did change the law. That the girls couldn't be given cuts to the guard. wasn't 2 or 3 weeks and pregnant, they kept crying, that crown died away. You sit with the rabbit, they were being whipped, they were getting hiding, and that was the end of the story. The crown of stopping by these young ladies was, it just came to an end. So that was that. But anyway, in 1963, the Transkei got self-government, and that was the year that I ended, in fact, I was a magistrate. And they were given the Departments of Justice, Education, Health, Interior, Agriculture, and Forestry, Rosenbergs, and with KD as the Chief Minister. He was called Chief Minister. And I think that your dad was, I think, under Secretary for Justice one time there too. Wasn't it? You might mistake a picture. In the later years. But and then, of course, that had to be an election. Now, what a job. That was the biggest job of my whole career. Because these people had never voted in their lives. They didn't even know what to vote. I mean, it's as far as you have to be. With them, one man rules, and that's all. I mean, they're used to having a chief who had powers of life and death, just about. And that's the way they were ruled. My chalk and all these chiefs, they just said, and so they weren't used to voting. All the things were run by chiefs and headmen and the royalty of the times. So we had to teach them what a vote was and how to vote, and we had numerous meetings in Mtata. That's why I think one of that photograph was taken. And we went to one of those meetings. We had to go to a meeting every month in Mtata to go and teach us how to conduct these elections, because they had wooden boxes and all the funny things like that. But to make things worse, the system they devised was that they were voting on regional basis. Otherwise, all the people in Eastern Pondland voted for the group. In those Western Pond, there were 9 members from the Transkei. I remember I was in the Eastern Pondland, and that was one group. I think it was the Lusikisiki, Flagstaff, Tamakuru, and I think Madara, or Kazana, if I'm not mistaken. And they were given 9 seats in the Transkei Parliament, but ended up there was 33 candidates. Ballot paper about this long, you know, about that wide. You know. Now you're dealing with illiterate people, and they would come in and you know what it is, and they say, "Who do you want on the US?" They all had the US been. I don't know. And you then had to read out the name, two. And "Who do you want?" Oh, I've forgotten now. Yeah, and it was actually terrible. It was. So you see what they did, they changed it, that they could bring little slips of paper with their names on. Who are they going to vote for? So that's how it was done. The parties would dish out pieces of paper. But anyway, basically the system with the election was held, and that was it. I'll never forget it. Well, while we were busy counting, the news came through that President Kennedy had been assassinated. So that was the time it was happening. And that was it. But anyway, at that stage, of course, that is when they knocked it, they got self-government. We were then seconded to the Transkei with generous housing and financial perks. We know we got a free house and free lights and water, and we got salary plus 25%. And the reason for that, of course, was to entice people to come and work in the Transkei, because a lot of these guys from Transvaal and Freestadt, they were not prepared to come and work in this, I won't say land, but you know what I mean. We're not prepared to come and work there for a black boss. And so they were offered these generous things. But I just loved it. Said, you know, I'm being paid a foreign affairs allowance here. I was born here. But I'm a foreigner in my own country, because I could not be a Transkei citizen. The act was that only people of African origin could be a citizen. So I joined in and I was quite happy to be called a foreigner and get foreign affairs allowance and get my book and pay nothing for the house and nothing for the water and all the rest of it. There's quite a story about it, because I remember when I retired, my wife, yeah. My late wife was a great gardener. You know? She loved gardening. Every time, you heard I'd moved about 12 times over, and just sometimes more than one house. But every time I went there, she'd make the garden, move that. And so that when we got here, of course, to Beacon Bay now, she started remodeling the old garden, and I put a house in Bonza Bay. And next, tong 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 on the door, and there was a bloke in said, "I'm from the municipality." So, yes, what's the problem? He said, "You were the biggest water account in the whole of Beacon Bay." So I said, must be leaking your meter. Meter was, and so they said, they'll check your meter, put a thing on there, and they said, don't use any water from 10 to 6 in the morning, and we'd come and check water when they came. No, no, nothing wrong. They said, where's the water at? I said, this lady is sitting there. She's got the sprinklers going from 9 to 5, and sometimes all night. And he says, well, he says, because he's used to having 3 nights in water. And I said, well, you've got to pay for it now. I said, I know, I've got to pay for it. I said, dear, I heard that. But anyway, that's how much it happened. But of course, then, as we know, after that, then the big thing was all in 1958, and I was in Slimming Flagstaff. The first black magistrate was appointed. Before that, for the first 5 years of their self government, we were still the same crew that you see on that picture over there. They can pass that picture around. And we were still the same crew, and in 1958, they decided to appoint the first black magistrate. Because there were a couple of them who had legal qualifications. And this guy, they looked to be made the first guy, first magistrate. He had passed his law years before, but because of the apartheid laws, he wasn't allowed to be a magistrate, and they put him into the deeds office, and he was a registrar of deeds for Transkei. So he became the first black magistrate of Transkei, and he was sent to Flagstaff to replace me. So I said, why am I being replaced? I thought, well, perhaps I'm kicked out there. I said, no, it's a feather in your cap. He said, we look for the best office, best run office in the area, and we picked you. But of course, what they did under those apartheid laws, they built a prefab in the yard, and I was moved to the Lusikisiki next door, because this magistrate, under the apartheid laws, could not try any case involving a white person. And he had limited jurisdiction in that respect. And also, he couldn't deal with whites really. I had to go there once a week. They put me prefab there to attend any cases involving white people, which was very, very few. I mean, Flagstaff only had about white people, as far as I know. And like births and deaths, birth managers and deaths, anything involving any white or colored person had to be dealt with by me. Well, I stuck it for a year, and I got transferred to Tottenham because it was a high school there. I believe after a couple of years, I gave it up as a day job. It was just a waste of time. I think they let that bloke just carry on and do what he did. But that was how things were. We all know what apartheid was and what it did. So this chap was a master, but he couldn't exercise all his functions in regard to certain races. But he was a very good guy, and I had full confidence in him, and I said so. But they made a very big thing of this thing, because there was no TV in those days. They brought all the had BBC then, American TV, all they were filming this big South Africa gets its first black magistrate. Big news. And because we had no TV, so we couldn't see it. We just saw it in the newspapers. But the big thing was 1976 when Transkei got full independence, and that was the creating as the president and the brother Georgie as prime minister. And then it was followed by the military coup, and my mother Misa, I'm not quite sure what year took place, but then I took it. But you see, you ask, I say, why were you involved in all these elections and funny things? I'll tell you now, and as Patrick will know, the magistrate was recognized as the administrative head and the senior representative of the government in his district. And I had a vast array of duties, quite apart from your judicial functions. In addition to being a magistrate, you had the post. You were the Native Commissioner. It was first Native Commissioner, then it was called Bantu Affairs Commissioner, then it was called District Commissioner. I mean, as the political situation changed, the Native Commissioner, that became a dirty word, then you became the Bantu Affairs Commissioner, and then that was also a dirty word, then it became the District Commissioner. And then you were the receiver of revenue. There was no one else there. You were the company. Every district there was the magistrate and 3 P's, both of us, priest and prison. and there were no other government departments there. There was a forestry department there, there was an agricultural department there, and there was a roads and works department, but they just had technical staff there. And so that we had to do their pay sheets and all the rest of it like that. But so you were also, as a receiver of revenue, you did everything. You paid the income tax there, you paid your car license there. We should driver's licenses, learner's licenses, car licenses, anything there, because we were full receivers of revenue. And we were the county officer of pension officer. We paid out the pensions with labour officer, commissioner of child welfare, and electoral officer, as you know, who just ran the elections. And you were ex-administrator of all intestate Transkeian estates. These guys die on the mines and they have money laying in the bank or something like that. And you were the executive. You had to go and draw that money out from the post office or the bank or something and pay it out to the heirs. And you had to visit the jail once a week. You were in charge of the jail. In fact, in essence, you had oversight over all government departments except the police and the post office. We had nothing to say about them. And you were regarded as the eyes and the ears and the mouth of the government. As a result, you had to divide your time between your admin work and your court work. And the more senior you became, the heavier the admin side came. I remember when I was transferred to Engcobo as the senior assistant magistrate. Old Mr. Mitchell was the magistrate there. And he said to me, Hooper, he said, the office is yours, the district is mine. And at that time, they were told that they had to spend 80% of their time in the district to promote this bump authorities thing. And something. We spent a lot of time in the district. And I loved it. I loved going in the district. It's nice. Have meetings and court work for me was boring and tiring because I knew that 9/10 of it was lies in any case. Don't tell the prisoner. And I found it ended. I only went to court on 2 days a week, one criminal court and one civil court. But of course, we had additional magistrates, assistant magistrates, and they depend on the number of the size of the district because they're different in size. You have small little districts like. I remember Butterworth, and I went to Butterworth. Butterworth was a small little one horse town when I went there in 1950 something. Very small. There was nothing in Butterworth. It was just from the car to the. I just ran the corner and that was that. There was nothing anybody with. There were just two magistrates there. But it depended, Engcobo had, I think, three or four magistrates there. And it depended on the size of Tot, had quite a lot. But so I was out in the AORM assistant, we called me in to do it on the other work, did it. So, but then the civil work I found quite interesting because I studied about the tribal custom. I found it very interesting. And especially the timber customers, this was timber land. And we find that the civil cases were all based on tribal customs arising from marriages, labola, inheritance. And then, you know, this migrant labor system really destroyed their family life. Because they would take a contract on the mines or something like that, or they'd go away for a year sometimes. They'd come back and find the missus is 6 months pregnant, you know. But the bonded tribal law had built in, amazing enough, they had built in a safeguard there because no self-respecting woman would have an affair without what they called a go-between. Had someone arranging it for them. And of course this person who was the go-between was the star witness because she was the only one who could corroborate it. So the whole case depended on this go-between who had to tell you what happened. And the same with the young girls. You look at the paper now, you see how the young girls are having babies and throwing them in the street and things like that. And they were very, very strict moral laws in the tribal system. It was punished. Adultery was punished by 5 head of cattle. They had to pay 5 head of cattle. And the girl was pregnant. They had to pay 3 head of cattle for that. And so the parents made quite sure that the girl or the lady would tell them exactly who it was because they wanted those cattle back. But amazing enough, they never divorced their wives. So we get the 5 head of cattle and then there's carry on with the marriage. But anyway, as far as crime was concerned, yeah, this differed from district to district. I remember when I was in Butterworth. They were quite enlightened people there. But I'm talking about the African people, not the white people. But I remember that Butterworth, I think we had 3 murder cases in a year. I went to Engcobo, we had 3 in 1 week. You know, because Engcobo borders on the Elliot McLean area. Yeah. And you know, from Engcobo, you just travel up here for about 20 miles, you go up the Southern Neck there. And the people lived there in the turfs and the bushes there, and they were still wearing these red blankets. oak and stuff like that. It was still, they were totally tribalized. And so that the crime was kind of pretty hefty on these people. I mean, they just walked around with battle axes and swords and nasty guys and stuff. And so there was a lot of kind of crime. But Engcobo, I found Engcobo and Libode to be the worst. Libode to be the worst for violent crime and stock theft. Stock theft was a profession. It was really a profession. It was exercised by families. That was their occupation. That is passed on from father to son, you know. That you stole, well, you do, I steal stock. the worst thing you can do to an African is to steal something from them. Because a lot of these blokes, when they were caught, they would come to court and pass their palace and bandaged up, like, and they catch a car and they beat him up, put on good, and then they call the peace. And so he had to seek two punishments. But we had a lot of serious assaults with acid cars, pangas, battle axes, sharpened sticks, swords. Conservation of Dacha was prevalent in Libode and also in the Lusikisiki, because down in the River Valley, that's where the prevalent of Dacha lived. In fact, the crime of Dacha and conservation became so rife that the Transkei government amended the law to provide for the maximum sentence of, minimum sentence of 5 years, compulsory. We had no option. If you were caught courting Dacha, it was given 5 years, no fine. And because what they were doing was that they were buying Dacha from the Lusikisiki Libode down there, and then it was going through to Cape Town or to Gampini, like that, or something. And I had quite a sad experience because two young Afrikaner boys were caught in Engcobo in the Bakkie. Bakkie was full of Dacha. These blokes, they didn't know what was Dacha. They were hired to come to the Transkei and collect something. But you can smell the thing of Mami Dacha, you know, Dacha is so strong, so pungent. You can smell it. I don't think we had plastic bags in those days. We should have probably cloth bags. You can smell it a mile away. I remember one case they brought to court, they picked all the Dacha in court as exhibit. And I couldn't breathe. I'd say, please, to get them out here, you know, it was choking me. And so I said, leave one bag there, that's enough evidence to prove it is Dacha. These young boys had to be given 5 years in jail. It's obvious, I mean, they were telling us, I didn't know what they were dying here. But they used to hire people to come here. These Dacha smugglers would hire people to come here to Transkei to call the Dacha through, because they thought perhaps white guys wouldn't be stopped. But these guys were stopped, and this pocket was full of Dacha. They came before me, and I found them guilty, and I had them in 5 years. I got a phone call from Cape Town. So they came from Cape Town. Now, if you know of recourse, the book said to me, who can you make Arama cunt in a so-and-so Thompson? How can you put my child in a jail? So I said to the lady in Afrikaans, I said, lady, your boys came here knowing what they were doing. They came here to smuggle Dacha. I said, Dacha is a prohibited substance anywhere in the world, in this country anyway. And I said that I'm very sorry, but they came to Transkei, they could abide by Transkei rules and laws. They committed their offence here. I said, if you want to, like, you can appeal if you want to do, or you can go and see the minister or ask whether. But I said, nothing that I can do about it. It was quite sad in a way. Mm-hmm. And of course, we had a, you know, because in those days, magistrates had a quite a limited jurisdiction. In ordinary cases, we had one year's prison sentences, but we couldn't go beyond 1 year. But in other cases, like this Dacha case, we were given increased jurisdiction to 5 years. For faction fighting, we were given increased jurisdiction to 2 years, 2.5 years. For stock theft, we were allowed to be up to 2.5 years, and certain crimes like that. But ordinarily, it was only 1 year. So of course, the cases went to the Supreme Court. And that's when they decided to introduce these regional courts, which was an intermediate court between the Magistrates Court and the Supreme Court. And they could try rape cases and cult cases, a couple of homicide things like that. But I see now that Magistrates try all kinds of cases, so things have changed a lot. But anyway, a lot of faction fighting took place, especially over the Pondos, over the fighters. We had faction fight there. One faction fight actually turned into almost an inter-tribal warfare. We had the police there with the helicopters and all kind of things. Oh, army and police there, trying to quell this thing. And of course, they go along and they burn the huts down and kill people. And things were wild in those days, you know. But anyway. And of course, the sinners on these crowns were ready to, according to. In those days, there was hard labor. You could only give a person a fine or imprisonment. There was nothing else. There was no this fancy thing about house arrest and all this community service. You either paid a fine or went to jail, or you just got to jail, no fines. And also, the males could be lashed, and that included adult males as well. In cases where a deadly weapon had been used, or even carried, lashes could be imposed. We used to impose 6 months and six lashes for people who chopped up somebody with a battle axe. And of course the judges didn't like it, and after some years they made a man stop. But that was the law. You know, what amazed me was the ability of these Africans to identify their stock. I mean, they knew their cow, they knew their sheep. I said, okay, but the cow, they had that brand. Sometimes they had brand, sometimes they didn't have brand. And I'll tell my story about the horse. I had a case that I was sitting there, how do you know it's all sheep? He said, I know my sheep. Well, you know, the Bible says that Jesus said, I know my sheep follow me. But I had a case where Mr. A's horse, say Mr. A's horse got missing the night before, and the police found the call, and found his horse at Mr. B's call. And Mr. B said, no, I didn't steal the horse, this horse was born and bred in my call. It's got a name on it, it comes to me. And Mr. A said, no, I bred this horse in my call, and it's mine, and it's got a name. So I said to the prosecutor, where's this horse? Because these rural courthouses, they're not like in town where you're in the main street. We had big yards there, you know. Back in the boat, even had a hitching rail for horses. They could tie their horses there. And so I said, it's in the palace. I said, we're going to fetch the horse. So we adjourned court, they fetched the horse, and they brought it down. And I said, okay, let's go out. We adjourned outside there. I said, okay, Mr. A, you take the horse. Said the policeman, you take the horse and you stand in the middle. And Mr. A, you stand there, and Mr. B, you stand there. And I said, okay, you both call your horse and see whose horse this is. Well, the horse inspector, Mr. A. So I said to Mr. B, there, I think he came back to court. I said, I find you guilty on the irrefutable evidence of Mr. Horse. But we're going to have fun in court sometimes. Boring. I had a man when once a bloke came to court and he hit somebody over the head for no rhyme or reason. I said, what are you hitting for? No reason. He said, why do you do it? Oh, he said, the devil told me to do it. So I said, well, do you want me to subpoena the devil? You know? And of course the people there roared with laughter, saying he was didn't want me to do to subpoena the devil in his defense. But and often, you know, people often say to me, weren't you scared? Big magistrate. But I was never afraid. I mean, I would be one white person among thousands of Africans when I had these meetings in Dublin there. And I think the fact that I was a Transkei born and bred, I could speak their language and I could relate to them and they could relate to me. I mean, it was a great advantage to me. And I never had any problems. And you know that the regard of the magistrate as the father, you were just like a governor there. As I say, you had all the government departments pouring under you. And once had a man come to me with a purely domestic thing. I said, no, this is outside my duties, man. I said, no. He said, of course, you must help me. You are our father. Nobody else can help me. You are our father. Oh, I thought, that's what people regard us as their father. So you were a magistrate, but you were a father figure and all sorts of things like that. So I helped him, and we managed to solve the problem, and that is that. But even a person, my Tanzima, he was of the old school, and I think this thing of magistrates, of course, it goes back right back to the annexation of Transkei, when Transkei was annexed, I think, like, almost like piecemeal. a magistrate, they put a magistrate there, and I don't know, but there was Sir Walter Stanford, and there was all the other guys with this old names that were appointed magistrates there. And he still is that he tells him what come to office and he say, "By it, Mikey." You know, salute me, Mikey, my Mikey is a magistrate. And of course then he's God giving me instructions, but by it me first and then he gives me instructions. But he had very respectful magistrates. In fact, you know, at the very end there, of course, as the years went off, there was, the first guy was appointed in 68. But as the years went by, more and more African matters were reported and we were shipped out to other places, plenty of jobs elsewhere. But so in the end, there were three of us left. I was in Engcobo, and the other guy was in Tata, the other guy was in Butterworth. And we got a call from KD. To the palace, the president's palace on Tata. And we thought, oh, we're getting chopped too. And I didn't want to go because I was born and bred, it's my home, you know. Anyway, right there, looking stores, it's going to happen to us now. So he said, look, I don't want you guys to leave. He said, I don't want you guys to leave. I said, no, we don't want to leave. I don't want you to leave because I want you to train my guys so that when you do retire, then these guys know what to do. But please, I want you to stay. I respect you and I trust you. And I want you. So he said, no, we're quite happy to stay till the end. But I never feel threatened in any way. In fact, there are some years ago, I was in Sparks. I live in Bonza Bay and I shop mostly in Sparks. There's only a K or two from my house. And the man came up to me and said, what am I getting? And Mikey is a magistrate. What am I getting? I said, who are you? And he said, don't you remember? I said, no. He said, don't you remember putting me in jail for 2 years for stealing a horse? I said, no, I put people in jail for stealing horses. And he was quite happy. And he said, he was quite happy to meet me. Really glad to see me. He said, I'm reformed now. I don't steal anymore. I'm a good guy. Amazing thing, even now, am I going past my time, gentlemen? Have I exceeded my time limit? But even now, I have people coming, meeting me in the shop or in the street and saying, Mr. Hooper, are you still alive? Are you tactful? Are you still alive? Yes, it's absolutely much alive. But I didn't ever meet, I said, yes, I'm not sure. Oh yes, I worked with you. In South Africa. I was there. I was a clerk of yours in Engcobo. I was somewhere with you in Blackstock. And just a few days ago, a woman came to me in Sparks supermarket there. Hello, Mr. Hooper. How are you? And I didn't know her from a bar or so, but she said yes. And so I went to my car, and then she came along with a man. She said, "This is my husband." She says that you married us in 1976. Oh. Yeah. They remembered me, so, but they were Engcobo people. So you see, I was in Engcobo for about 14 years. So they everybody knew me. You know, I was sort of part of the furniture there. And I was really sad to leave. But so this happened. I often see people that come and they speak to me. I'm known for the far and wide, but it is a good time. And but just to now to extend off, I'll just say that there now and then, or then and now. You know the laws have changed completely since. I mean, I've been gone 27 years, and I think that anybody who's out of his profession for 27 years, if you ever go back to what you were doing, you'll probably find that things have changed. Think automation has come in, and new machines have come in, and all kinds of things. And I think even the doctor replied that after 27 years, you ain't working in practice, you go back down, you'll find there's a lot of things they have changed and stuff like that. But when I watch the news and see what's going on there, I realise, I was actually quite glad to be out of it because most of us have been trying all these funny cases. They're getting, we call them funny cases because we tried crime cases. The stuff going to the message now is funny stuff. Because a lot of it is semi-political, a lot of it's corruption. We don't have much corruption. We had some of our clerks punching money and we put them inside. But I mean, now you've got high profile cases where You know, we counselors and mayors and ministers and so I've been involved in crime. We didn't have that. That didn't exist at all. And you know, I told you that the way what we are to do. And but you know, these new things we find about this regular house arrest, correctional supervision, community service, plea bargaining. I mean, plea bargaining would have been an offence in the olden days. And, you know, you were doing things on the door, but now the prosecutor and the attorney can get together and come to an agreement. You know, that we'll ask them if you plead guilty, and instead of getting 2 years, we'll get 3 months. You know, so they work out some plea bargaining. And so that is totally unknown to us. I mean, parole was totally unknown to our mind. I don't remember parole, but the first offender got a remission, what they call a remission of 1/3 of his sentence. And you remember the famous Pistorius case, I mean, the guy who shot his girlfriend. This guy was given 5 years the first time, and I think after 10 months he was released on parole. Now, in my day, if you got 5 years, you'd have to serve 2/3 of that, which was, I think, 40 months. And you would have got 20 months parole. So that, I mean, these days, imagine 5 years and you serve 10 months. I mean, you know, I don't think it's right. But I think the problem is these days is that your prisons are over full. Like they can't cope with the number of people coming. And so they're trying to ship them out as quick as they can. Any excuse that they put him on parole, they didn't let him go. But I mean, all these guys are back again in a couple of weeks' time with the same offence. But it actually shocked me when I listened to Pistorius' case to see how things went, how things had changed. Because I mean, it was televised, and I don't know what the public thought, because I mean, for me as a trained magistrate, I mean, it did shock me really to see how things were done these days. And I don't know what the public thought of it, but I suppose it's just education for you. But I mean, it was a good life. It's a nice life. Transkei was a lovely place. You know, the people who come from the Transkei know, you know, every little dorp, it had a tennis court, a golf course, what's it called? What do you call it? And there was some place even had even bowls. And we even played rugby in the Transkei. We were playing rugby for Kung, played Kung against Fred. And you know, the Transkei itself had a very good rugby team. And Tata had three teams there. And the Transkei played in the border league here. Yeah. Against Buffs and Del Silbornians, all that kind of thing there. And in fact, we even produced a Springbok captain. Basil Kenyon was a Transkei boy. His dad worked in the Boonga there. He worked in the Bunga. And his other brother, I think it was Don Kenyon. Is that Don Kenyon?
His father.
He was a magistrate too. I think he was a pig or something. Then he joined the dispatch as a cartoonist. So he also knows what I'm talking about magistrate. These two are both magistrate sons over here, so I'm talking to the converted here. But anyway, thanks for inviting me. I hope it'll be the last time I give this talk. Now I'm tired of it now. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Mr. Hooper. Before you go, are there any questions anyone would like to ask?
Oh, sorry, what do you have to remind you? All right.
What was the highest sentence you could give in a magistrate's court before we had to refer it to a higher court? What could a Transkei magistrate?
We see certain crimes that we couldn't try. We couldn't try rape cases and murder cases. Our normal jurisdiction was only 1 year in those days. But except for fighting, stopped after that, and we were allowed to give bumper case operations. But it is mainly murder and rape that we took the High Court to change. And in fact, the ending of the 3 months had to go on review in those days. It had to be typed and set on review to differential. And it's quite a strange question. I mean, a lot of the cases, but most cases went out in 3 months anyway, and had to go for review to be approved by the judge. But maybe we were debarred from trying to murder and rape and even come to homicide.
Anything, any other questions?
No, where were you during the Buckler movement? Where were you stationed when the Buckler movement was going through?
I was just left in Goma, and I was transferred to the Bodhi when they killed those people at the bridge, Massey Bridge. Now, I was so fed up when I saw the paper that these guys were being here. Their bodies were brought back from where they were buried, they were hanged, and brought back as heroes, you know, for what they'd done. And what they did, they extorted a broker and his wife. He was a tractor driver or something like that. And his wife and two little girls living in a caravan at the road camp, and a young bloke who was a mechanic or something like that. And then I was transferred to Libode, because Libode was quite quiet. They didn't have port call there. But I was at Engcobo, and then I went to Libode, because I was in Libode 3 times and I was in Goma twice, but I was assistant there. That's when the portal was on at the Goma time. And Goma was quite a political hotbed, because you know that these our political leaders like Mandela and the other big boys, Becky, they all come from that area. Goma and Ducha and Toto, all those places, that's where they came from. Blokes who are now ruling this country. But the Porto, of course, was a terrorist organization, as you know. But so I went up to a bloke who came back and he buried there with great honors because he did a serve for the Porto army and he killed these poor little people living in a rope camp. And so I said so.
Okay, well then, could I call on Dr. Hutchison to express a vote of thanks?
Uncle Des, what a wonderful trip down memory lane. You bring back many fond memories of my dad.
Yeah.
Who of you folks have read that book that came out about 10 years ago by Sean Johnson, the Native Commissioner?
Yes, I've got the book.
Anyone familiar with the book? No.
Yes, I've got it, yes.
Yes. That was Sean Johnson, a journalist who, shortly after the News South Africa, brought out a book called Strange Days Indeed. I think that was his first book. Then his second book was The Native Commissioner.
Oh, he actually changed names there.
Yes. And that book describes my father's life and Des's life very closely, because his father is sitting in extreme left of the middle row in this, was the Native Commissioner. And Sean Johnson sort of reviewed his life growing up in Transkei. I found it amazing reading that book because he lived in all the houses that we lived in. Kentani, Libode, and he describes the places and the things that we experienced. And I'm sure you and your family
I worked for him for 2 years. I was his assistant magistrate before I was promoted to put to magistrate next door.
Yes. Of course, the houses that we lived in, our address never changed. It was always the residency. Or Kentani. Why was it called the residency? Because those houses were built not for magistrates, for government agents in foreign territory before the Transkei territories were annexed. So they were the sort of, what would you call, the government agents' residence. And that's why they're called the residency. Number plate, we thought we were terribly important. Our dad's car was always had number one, CDY1, CCD. Butterworth was 100. But of course, we live in a different age now, and we sort of think you read the reality of the situation now, and you think, my goodness, we lived through those times. We lived through those times. My dad was the government resident agent representing the government. What government was it? This was the apartheid government. Really? He was such a nice, likable guy.
We did our job.
Of that. So you try and reconcile how this works, and you wonder, well, how did these magistrates feel? Were they conscious of apartheid and all that? Were we conscious of apartheid? You know, no, they were just doing their duty as best they could. But there is an illustration. In my first year of varsity at Stellenbosch, I came back. We were living in Mthatha. I think my father was chief magistrate of Mthatha, assistant secretary for justice in Mthatha at the time. Of course, the boss was Pretoria, and boss was very much around. There was a security agency around, keeping apartheid and the whole system. I came back on holiday quite innocently and walked around town, went shopping in my new SAS t-shirt. Well, this information got back to the chief magistrate quite quickly, and he called me aside and he said, my boy, you're now a man. I can't really tell you what to do, but I can ask you, please, don't make my life more difficult than it is. If you walk around town in that t-shirt, I can't stop you. But just know, you're creating serious problems for your father. I can't remember, but I like to think I didn't wear it in the dark. But Uncle Des, we've all thoroughly enjoyed your talk tonight. It's been very illustrative of what my dad did, what you did.
Yeah.
And I believe you served a very important function as Mankie, as father of the people.
Yes.
As government agent, I can't believe you ever saw yourself as a terrible apartheid enforcer of evil laws. I thank you for coming here tonight and enlightening us.
It was a pleasure.
And unga dinwa.
Nagomuso.
Live long, don't get tired.
Nagomuso.
Thank you very much.
I don't know.
There's no present, Uncle. There's just a great big thanks.
No. No, we do that, George. We give that ticket a bookmark.